November as task force meeting. We are very much moving from the big picture to working closely with the small, the smaller picture, which is the most important, and that's where we get on the groundwork with understanding what's going on in our schools. Right now, we've been kind of looking at the city as a whole, and today, we will look at it from the perspective of equity and have a presentation on equity. Welcome to the task force members. The focus groups are happening all over the city, and I want to thank you all for doing the focus groups. And I also would like to encourage you that if some of the people in your area, constituents and parents and leaders are not able to attend yours, you can share with them the dates that I sent you in regards to OSSE doing focus groups. And so as we move on from there, I just want to kind of just quickly say what we did last time. That was, and I would like to give a special thanks out to Josh Roots, who, Josh, thank you for your 2017 park presentation, and we are looking forward to future presentation once we have the park scored along with 2016-2017 equity report, so that we can really look closely at that. As of right now, it probably will not be ready for us to discuss in our December meeting. It'll probably come out the end of November, but not give enough time for us to actually dive into it. So we'll probably hold it in abeyance for another month or so, but we're moving in that direction. I also like to thank OSSE last month for actually creating and field testing and taking our feedback on the report card focus group deck. The changes were very helpful in the field. Those of us that had an opportunity to use it can see the difference. We also, initially, they were supposed to give it to us in English, Spanish, and Arabic. We now have it in Spanish and Arabic. So if you visit their website, you can find it in that language, in those languages as well. Now we're just going to move on from the big picture to the grassroots, and we're going to start off with getting Justin to speak to us. He's going to speak to us about the report card status, what's happening in our focus groups, to give us a big picture of how it's going in our communities, and then next month we'll have another guest.
It's still very early in our engagement process. We're starting to get some momentum and traction, which is also really good. So we're starting to saturate the community. People know what we're doing. People are signing up for events. But there's still a whole lot more to do, as there usually always is. You've seen this slide before. We had three phases of engagement. We are in the phase that's focusing on selecting content for our report card that will run through the early winter of this year. We'll also come back in winter, the winter and spring, to talk about design, and then we'll prepare for launch in April 2022. You've also seen this slide, so remember this is our general timeline, and November 7th meeting, we said that we would come back to you and do what we're doing today. All right, as Lynette mentioned, one of the most fruitful conversations that we had was about the tool itself. And the feedback that you all gave us last month, we incorporated right back into the tool. We shortened the length of time needed to complete the full set of exercises. We also simplified the activities and got rid of the edgy jargon piece altogether, and also developed a glossary, which is actually pretty helpful behind the report card at public engagement. So the glossary is a helpful tool. We also flipped the sequence of events, so the engagement script starts with the top three, bottom three exercise, which after last night doing with the student group, I thought made a lot more sense. And then we also simplified the feedback collection. So all this was feedback that came right from you guys, and we made that immediately to the teachers.
So let's talk a little bit about what we've heard so far. One thing that I just want to reiterate that Justin mentioned before, one of our big takeaways, is that it's early in the process. So the data that you're going to see here is based on about 100 respondents. We know this is going to change over time. This is like the snapshot that we have. So you can see here we did a breakdown of the respondents, primarily working with teachers, and that's great. That is what we are looking for. Excuse me, parents, which is what we are looking for. We also have some teachers, administrators, and other in the in-person feedback sessions. You can then also see a breakdown of bullet like board and some demographics and some other key pieces around the respondents so far in the in-person sessions. Excuse me. I'm not going to walk through all of this, but just go ahead and take a look and just see essentially what we've got so far.
We'll go to the next slide.
How does this relate to the actual populations that our various schools serve in the city? So what percentage of the actual parents or administrators or teachers are we getting?
I think that is something, this is just on the, that's a great question. This is just based on the in-person sessions. We're going to walk through kind of the breakdown for the other sessions. I think that that is a great question. It's something we can do at once we have collected more of the feedback. We can kind of take a look at that. But it's definitely one of the reasons we want to get all the information back from you guys around demographics so that we can kind of do some of that analysis and have a sense of who we're getting, what coverage looks like.
So this feedback was also to November 2nd.
Yes.
So when we said that we were making traction, so since November 2nd, we've doubled the number of respondents. We just don't have data.
So this is the breakdown for the online survey. Again, we are hitting primarily parents, which is wonderful. We also have some community members included in the online survey, CBOs and advocates, as well as some non-responses we're not required to fill in demographic questions. And then you can see the breakdown for coverage and demographic information on the
one of the things that everybody can continuously do is push people to the survey. Push people to the survey. Surveys are actually a pretty good tool. I've got a model study group that I pushed to them, and we had there a bunch of new dads, so I'm looking to it. If you're going to have a Friendsgiving party, pull out the survey for Friendsgiving. Yes. But,
this is based off of right now, the survey specifically, the total respondents, this is based off about 100 folks. We can do the individual breakdowns going forward if you're interested in just
not 100.
This is in person and online. 100 total.
Yes.
Correct.
Which is why we need to keep pushing.
And again, this is as of November 2nd, so we know that already we've got more responses and more information coming in.
So the online, those are the wards that answered online?
Correct.
And the last one were in person?
Correct.
Did we put back to the in-person sessions?
So in-person, it's like 43 of the in-person sessions were based on 48, 19, or 5, 14, or 7. As folks identified. So we also wanted to share feedback so far. fallen into both the priority and the, or the top six and the bottom six, to just like call that out. So we're going to be continuing to take a look at that. But again, it's early on in the feedback. Nothing right now is clearly popping to the top or falling to the bottom, but we'll continue to look at it.
And things, so just to prepare, you could also get information back that that people or certain communities thought, hey, top six and bottom six, because it just depends. Like, you might have a number of parents that say that are pre-K and don't really care about graduation just yet, but they care a whole lot about pre-K observations and pre-K scores. So it's very obvious to see. So it's, you could get in both categories.
So there isn't a question on the survey that says, are you filling this out based on your frame of reference, being high school or middle school or elementary school or multiple of the above?
I'm not sure. I have to go back and look at the tool.
Yeah, and I would just be interested that there was a question.
Okay.
There's somewhere on there that asks what is your frame, because obviously all the ones on the top are very high school centric. Big case for it.
So there was no question about that, I believe, and that was one thing that came up during our focus groups, because people were like, okay, like, right now, pre-K is very important, but, like, however many years down the road, it's not going to be as important, so they asked questions about that.
Yeah, because I don't know if we're required to report this somewhere in a public manner or something that's voidable later on, because that seems like if we choose not to, for whatever reason, put school-related arrests on the front page, here it's going to be like, oh, it's in the top six. But that's only because the vast majority of people filling this out had high school students versus they weren't any. We don't have parents who have kids that are 1 and 2 filling this out, because they just said, right, I just want to make sure that we, if somehow, if we can, even add a question to the survey now that talks about how are you mainly, what is your main frame of reference?
So I would also raise a question. Some of this data is not relevant.
The most unpopular.
Yeah.
Of the six.
Is the most unpopular?
Most unpopular. All right.
Again, early on, it'll be more, probably more clear. These are good, like, you know, hypotheses to dig into once we see how the data is playing out.
So remember, the second activity is the builded activity. So this is where you are identifying, here are the things that I care about, and here's how I expect to see it. So we're going to teach our activities. So in this activity, we're starting, again, we're seeing a lot of interest in the general theme of graduation college preparedness. But we're seeing it that, like, people are wanting it displayed in different ways. For example, annual graduation rate or college acceptance data. We're also seeing a lot of, approximately 15% of feedback of responses are pertaining to teacher data. But again, teacher data ranges a whole gamut from effectiveness data to retention to turnover to satisfaction to
teacher-student ratio to demographics of schools. So it's teacher data important, but exactly what I would expect to see is very different. Parent engagement is number three. So this is all over the map in how you would measure it. So some of it ranges from, oh, I care about how I am engaged, like what mediums do you have to engage me as a parent, versus how, like, how many people attend certain events in this room. This one's school safety, again, lots of a wide variety. I also saw this in the student meeting. Some people cared a lot about alternative practices to discipline, but some people also wanted, like, counts, and some people wanted to know, like, do you have sort of justice programs, but do you have, like, security systems, and what does that security look like? What are the policies? So some people wanted descriptions, some people wanted, like, actual counts. Thought that was interesting last time. Test scores, that's pretty standard. Transportation is also a big one, and this is just generally what transportation opportunities are around the school.
So, as we said, it's early on in feedback. We have a lot more to do, and based on, you know, this information is based on about 100 respondents. We are definitely going to ask, and if you're encouraging you guys to...
When we say we, we.
So all get out there. And in addition, like, you know, we're obviously asking, you know, for your help. We wanted to talk a little bit about what we're doing to both support that and to also do encourage outreach at OSSE. So we've been leveraging some community-based organizations by, like, providing some small grants to, like, target specific populations and groups. We've been putting together different supports for the task force at PTO. So by providing, like, consultation and childcare, food, et cetera, to, you know, further enable these conversations, as well as working with parent-focused education partners like CAVE and board education councils to additional solicit additional feedback. So we're with you in
Remember, you can always point people to the survey, push them to the link. You can do everything from sign up the host, find a session, send sample emails, take the online survey. All of that is on this link here. Also, a couple upcoming OSSE-led sessions. So the first one is tomorrow night at the Bellevue Library from 6 to 7:30. I've also seen some Twitter traffic from the State Board, so thank you for pushing these out. Next Monday, the 13th, at the Lehman Mids Library. And then Monday, November 20th, at the Bain Library. And I can also make sure I get these to Maria. I think she probably had quite some of these. This is should be familiar. What you can do, okay, is send back your forms. So some of you, as you're sending or if you're holding your events, get those back into us. Make sure you send us your sign-in sheets. Make sure you send us your demographic information and also your feedback. I know that that many of you have once mentioned that you cannot write an analysis of what I've heard. Absolutely. Send it, but also send the feedback forms too.
It will just help us to be able to do those breakdowns and answer some of the questions like, what does coverage look like? Are we reaching those that we want to? Those demographic forms will help us.
And it keeps the feedback consistent across for the people that are push your contacts to sign up to host an engagement session or fill out the survey. And here is the link again, because I want you to tweet it right now. If you have it at your phone, tweet something, push your people out there and do it. I'll leave this up for a few minutes, but make sure you push your people to do it. Okay. Any other questions, comments, concerns?
If you do modify the survey, to ask about the frame of reference, my recommendation would probably ask them, are there comments from grant, like, it might be split all, but maybe the actual category should be pre-K through second grade, grade level where I don't have hard data.
It would be great if maybe just find me out a good example of what you did. That would be awesome. I think that would be very helpful.
Yeah, I might also just tweet it. And I'm just saying that while third through eighth grade is in high school, that's your frame of reference.
Yeah, to, like, group it for them, so give options versus just like, yeah, what's your frame of reference?
Yeah.
So that we're getting the answers there.
But
into our presentation on equity. And I just want to give you a little bit of information on the bio on Dr. Lowery. I thought this was a really interesting quote that she made. Leaders, parents, communities must expect a certain level of rigor and performance if we want to close the achievement gap. Dr. Lowery is Vice President of Pre-K to 12 Policy, Research, and Practice at Ed Education Trust. As Vice President, Dr. Lowery leads Ed Trust, P-12 team for developing implementing powerful strategies to focus national attention on inequities in public education, as well as the actions necessary to close gaps in opportunity and to improve achievement. The National Association of the State Boards of Education honored Dr. Lowery in 2015 as the Policy Leader of the Year. The honor is awarded annually to a national or state policymaker in recognition of his or her contributions to education. Dr. Lowery brings with her a wealth of experience as an educator, district and state leader, and education advocate. Most recently, she served as president and CEO of Future Ready Columbus, where she led a commission representatives from across the Columbus, Ohio region to focus on college and workforce readiness. Prior to her time in Ohio, she served as an education leader for two states, both as the State Superintendent of Schools for the Maryland State Board of Education and the Secretary of Education for the State of Delaware. Additionally, Dr. Lowery served as superintendent of the Christina School District in Newcastle County, Delaware, assistant superintendent of Fairfax County Public Schools in Fairfax County, Virginia, and an area administrator for Fort Wayne Community Schools in Fort Wayne, Indiana. She also has school level experience, having been a high school principal, an assistant principal, a minority student achievement mentor, and a secondary English teacher. John King, president and CEO of the Ed Trust, I'm going to quote him. He said that Lillian's strongly held belief in capacity of all children to learn to high levels, her experience as an educator, and deep experience in complexities of leading districts and states makes her the ideal person to advance our equity agenda. And he mentioned that he was looking forward to working closely with her and to improve the education of our nation's most vulnerable youth. Welcome, Dr. Lowery. Thank you.
Good evening. I have the pleasure of working with former Secretary John King. John and I served as state leaders together, and one of the reasons he invited me to come to the Education Trust with him is because of the reorganization of the Elementary Secondary Education Act, also known as ESSA. The accountability is pivoted to the state, and we have some amazing people in the organization around data analytics and policy and research, and now that we're going to be working directly with the state, John put it important to have people with that practice experience in schools at the state level to
giving kudos to the B12 team for putting together this deck tonight with the data. You will notice that at the bottom of each deck where there are data that we have contributed to where those data come. So the purpose of tonight is at the end, around 7:55, we hope that the task force will have come to consensus on a working draft of what equity means. This is a conversation we're having even at Trust. Equity has become the new buzzword, and a lot of times when people talk about equity, they could be talking about very different things. So what we're going to do is a data overview, and my team, by the way, because they are researchers, looked at the task force and they said, Lillian, you have some people on there who know data. So if there are any parts of the data that you want to discuss, you probably know your data better than I. We can do that. But the overarching reason for looking at the data is just to get a lens for the conversation when we break into small groups around framing an equity discussion. So when we get in a small group, we're going to count off 1, 2, 3, 4, and we're going to go over the principles, the 5 principles of equity as described by Professor Paul Gorski from George Mason University, who teaches courses on class and poverty, and has also begun an undergraduate degree on social justice. And we're going to hope that in the small groups, you will come to consensus on what themes cut across all of your thinking. And then we're going to come back to the committee of the whole, the entire task force, and try to now, among those groups, come to consensus as one body on what the principles of equity are and how it will inform the work moving forward. So we're just, these are snapshots, these are lenses, and we're looking at different, we're looking at who our students are in the Washington, D.C. area. We're looking at how they perform, and then we're going to be looking at some of the ways that we might evaluate depending on what happens to them here in our schools. So the first is the fact that almost 3/4 of D.C. students are Black, and most are from low-income families. And when I looked at that first data point, the percentage of students receiving peer reduced lunch is 99%. I went to the team, I'm like, wait a minute, I'm going to have to be able to talk about this. What's happening there is because we have a community eligibility provision. So once we reach that 40% mark, the entire school is considered peer reduced lunch eligible. So I think when we break it down, it's about 62%, but we can get those data for you. So when we look at the percent of children in poverty, so that kind of levels out the data point. About 11% of those students are English learners, and about 15% students with disabilities. I'm just going to go through these unless you want to stop and discuss, and we'll do that. So over the last 10 years, the English language learners, I have raised about 8% to 11%. So that population is growing. The 8 boards, and when you look at the colors, the yellow, and I think it's in your book, are the Black students, the blue, the Latino, the purple, the white, red, Asian, two or more is green. So just look board by board and you see your demographic. When we look at wards 2 and 3, we see that they have the fewest students who qualify for career increase lunch. Yes. Where they go to school. We're looking at schools. Because I know you kind of do some shows to get terms and all those
stuff. And just to clarify, the first data is from NCDS, and the score data is the OSSE data, so it's two different
information. Absolutely. Okay. And what we are giving you is the most current data we could find on any of these points. And that's why we wanted to make sure we attribute it from where we got the data so you'll know where, from where and what year. And by the way, Darren gave me your website, so now my team is all apprised of your website, so they perused it. I don't know. It informed the work. I don't know if they used it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I don't have any enrollment stuff up there.
Yeah.
But, got it.
Okay, so.
Sorry, these are public school students.
Yes, only public school students, which includes charters. So we need to be public. Okay, And so what do the achievement results look like in DC? And these are NAEP data, and everyone is familiar with NAEP, of course, and the last administration was 2015. So these data come from the 2015 administration. 27% of all DC fourth graders score proficient. And I wanted to look at that because when one looks at 27% in isolation, it's like, wow. I wanted to make sure when I look at the national data that nationally, 36% of fourth graders are at proficient level. So DC is doing well, comparatively speaking, as a nation, if 36% is the national level. Yes.
So not all fourth and not all eighth graders take the NAEP. So do you have like how many the guidance that school are randomly chosen?
And NAEP is structured that way on purpose, so nobody can study for the test, nobody can teach for the test, and so it's a randomized assessment that will just give us data based on those who are assessed. We make sure that we don't use students' names. We have no identifying.
No, I understand, but I'm just wondering if you have an idea of how many of the fourth graders in DC actually.
I don't know. Would you look the while 27% overall score proficient, lower results for black students. And I think that's going to be the thing as we go through these data. Two out of three higher income fourth graders, one out of seven. Less than one out of seven for low income. So when we start talking about framing this conversation around equity, these are the data points, and part of the conversation in the group would be why do we think that is as it is. Most groups of students have improved over time with faster gains for Black and Latinos. And so when a statement is made like that, and you see the data, what do the data tell us? Story are you doing? Blacks and Latinos have improved over time compared to others. Where are white students already performing? Our white students are already at the top. They are above the cutoff score for position. So is improvement for our Black and Latino students, so that is a celebratory point. They have always, they're the gap. I want you to see the gap. 19% of all 8th graders score proficient or higher on math, and we're only dealing with proficient because proficient means they're operating, performing on grade level, and they can use those data in analytical ways to apply the knowledge that they have. Only 13% of Black students. Okay, DC schools got almost half of their higher income 8th graders to grade level in math.
Clarification on that again. This, what we're seeing right now, the improvement for and fourth graders, this is just DC, or is this
just DC? from 240 to 256. This is about a 16-point gain for Black students in particular. And so my researchers thought that was substantial. I guess they're the best of us. Now we're to PAR. And since you guys are really familiar with these data, the gap is what we just need to focus on. Similarly in math, you are making progress here in D.C. The gaps still persist. And I think that's nationally what we're seeing is everyone is doing better, but the gaps are moving with everyone. And so when I looked at those survey and focus group data on pre-K, the question we need to ask ourselves, especially in D.C., you do a great job with your folks with pre-K, probably more so than other states, if they are starting out with the same opportunity, if they are starting out with the same opportunity, where does this gap grow and how does it grow? I think that should be a part of the conversation that we have. And that will get into a discussion about equal versus equity. ELA PARC results vary by ward here. The research shows, unfortunately, that if we look at socioeconomic status, we tend to look at higher or lower performance proficiency. And what we can no longer do in our country, and D.C. is just a microcosm of the country at large, is be okay with that being the answer that if one is wealthy, then one is going to do well. And if one is not wealthy, relegate that person to a lower performance and probably more opportunities if he or she passes too much. Same thing in math. If you look at awards, you know your awards better than I, so you know who those students are. Now let's look at the SAT results and the disparity in outcomes of the different groups. Order of DC students meet college rating benchmarks on the SAT, and you can see the results by group. This is one, and I was going to kind of get this as every slide, but let me start here. This is why it's so important that we have disaggregated data, because when you look at averages, we get lost in averages. So it's important for us to know exactly how much of our students are doing.
I have a question. So for the college ready benchmark, is it that a child needs to meet, or students need to meet both reading and math, or is it for students to meet either one?
For
the college ready benchmark.
For the college ready benchmark, we're
looking at both.
Well, we're looking at an SAT score, which is a combination of all.
So it's not hard to know how they're going to read and how they're going to read.
There are parts that are math, there are parts that are reading, and they have a composite score.
No, I was just asking a question about this is a composite score.
That's
saying how prepared are they for college overall.
Absolutely.
They're not saying how students are doing on reading, but that a student needs to be both college ready for reading and college ready for math. There are oftentimes gaps,
right?
And they can be large.
Absolutely. This is a composite score.
Yeah, college were only. For the purposes of this kind of study,
does
the complete composite.
Yes.
Do you have a chance to know the college ready benchmarks and what score both like those this would consider college ready?
So the SAT has a cutoff score, and it depends on what colleges and universities take. So some colleges and universities have a cutoff score of a certain score, say 1600 is the highest.
The SAT also introduced last year separate scores that are college ready for math and for administration reading and writing. So there is actually a college ready class, which I think is why the confusion too when you're lumping it, because it is subject specific now, new in the last year.
Right. I can see if my team has that when we send those data. Because they had to get their composite data somewhere. I know that they just look at the composite score.
It's similar, but for DC, the math is about 8 to 10% lower than that evidence-based reading and writing.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I did.
Graduation. One in three students do not graduate from high school. nearly one in three DC students do not graduate from high school in 4 years. More than half of students with disabilities do not graduate on time. And this is a four-year adjusted cohort.
And just for a frame of reference for this group, OSSE released the graduation rate data at the state level just today.
Oh.
This is when they made their presentation. It was 69 last year. It's now 72 this year. And they also didn't really, it's just a press release for the overall rate number, so you wouldn't even be able to update the rest of it. So I assume that those gaps still persist, but you did go from 69 to 72 at the state.
So that's good news.
Yes.
One more point of clarity. So we did learn about the ESSA STAR framework rating. We did notice that the subgroup for special education and all the other subgroups combined were 5 points each, but special education was 10 points. So we did work a little bit more in terms of the overall score. So I think all the points you're making are super valid. There are state board members on it. We just that when we saw that, we did see that special education. When all races combined are just worth 5 points. Just to be thinking of when we see that.
These are graduation rates by ward. And that goes back to the earlier question from a couple of the task force members. What do we mean by college and career ready? So we're graduating, the students are graduating. The question when you start talking about equity is, what do they do after they graduate? Where are they going? Are they going to college? Are they going to work? Are they going to a training program? Are they going to the military? The goal is to make sure that when our children leave the school, they are going to something. And you can see that within DCPS, even within a single ward, graduation rates vary by schools. And so here we have the high schools and the wards. Disparities in achievement are a direct result of gaps in opportunity. And so now we're going to have a discussion or at least view data. What do we know about differences in opportunity to learn in DC? Now, here is where I expect a lot of daily discussion because you know your district and your school is far better than I. I'm sharing data. I was holding the mirror or something, right? Less access to early learning opportunities. So when we saw that within the last six, I love Josh's question. Who are the parents being either in the focus group being questioned or on the surveys? Because I think it matters. It's relevant, usually. Children from low-income families in DC are less likely to be enrolled in preschool. And you see high-income and low-income. And I don't like the gap, but it's not a bad gap, relatively speaking, and compared to other students. Rigorous courses. And this is one that grades Y are, as a former high school principal, white students in D.C. are much more likely than their black and Latino peers to be enrolled in higher level math in eighth grade. We need to, in those small groups, talk about why. If the parents, if many of our students are going to end up being first generation parents, where do we put resources around our children in schools? Is it after school wraparound programs? Where do we help prepare our students to know that those advantages are there?
I'd like to make the observation that there may also, in more likely, also be a stretch of the classroom. And even though some efforts could be made, it's pretty new.
Well, I don't want to tell So if you, what I'll do is I'll send you back what I know that we have if you need, and if you have any questions, I can ask the data analytics team to kind of see some more about that. Children from low-income families, English learners, and students with disabilities are also less likely to be enrolled in higher level math. Smartest kid I ever taught, his first name is Greg, I won't even bless him, in North Carolina, my hometown, had dual designation. He was gifted and he was learning disabled. Now, he probably had a milder form of the learning disability because it was not as severe as some, but he definitely had those processing deficiencies and he was brilliant. And we started doing research more around these students who are duly designated so that we are addressing all the needs. What we found when I was at Fairfax County is that 65%, these are normally healthy kids, most of them, a lot of them, 65% of the students who were designated with disabilities are in college somewhere. And because now more and more colleges and universities are also providing services. Black and Latino students are underrepresented in the population of kids, students taking advanced placement exams. How many of you, are we sure, and you probably know better than I, that we offer advanced placement or IB courses in every high school? Because I was in Baltimore, State Superintendent, when Freddie Gray happened, and I went with the team that went to Jeffrey Jefferson High School, where LeBron and Brian was eliminated. Here I was a state superintendent of schools living in this bubble. I had no idea that there were high schools in the wealthy state of Maryland that did not offer AP or IB, and they did not at that school. And they had honors classes, and when we did a survey of those classes, we found there was really not that much difference between honors and regular class. So those kids talk about a level playing field. So they're going to graduate number one, number two in their classes, and they're going to go off to college or opportunity and realize that they're nowhere near as prepared as some of their classmates who live right across the city. So when we talk about who's underrepresented, we also need to just do a survey to make sure that even if they want to, the opportunity exists. 31% of the exams taken by all of DC students received a score of 3 or higher as compared to only 14% of exams taken by black students. You see the data disaggregation. AP access success vary by school, and that's the point that I just made. There are likely disparities within schools as well. One of the things, when we talk about equity, when I was a high school principal, I instituted this rule at my school where we have open access. And then I said to the staff, and they aren't coming out until they get the first quarter. So when they get another first quarter, don't try to scare them out and tell them that they are in the wrong place because you're going to have to live with them for at least one quarter. Also had to do some work with parents to say, I know you're used to your children getting A's when they're not being stretched, but if they're going to take this more rigorous course of study, they may get a C. I kind of, you know, maybe feel a little better with the 0.5 that we added to it, but it's okay if they're being stretched and acclimating to a more rigorous course. So we have to do counseling with parents, we have to do counseling. I had kids in my office in tears wanting to come out the first week, and I wouldn't. I think it was hard, the hardest thing I've ever done. By the end of the first quarter, at least 2/3 of them stayed. They just needed to get over that hump and realize that they had a teacher who was going to work with them. AP success presented as a table. You have it in your book, so you'll probably get to see it better there.
Participation.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
strong teachers and teachers who look like them. They have started last summer, but it's just continuing to be in the environment around diversity of the workforce. And there are the research points that say students who have minority teachers, minority students in elementary school are more likely to graduate from high school and also go to college because there are no microaggressions, there are no implicit biases, and people hold high expectations. And they see role models. So this is a picture. In D.C. school serving, the most students from low-income families have a great proportion of new, out-of-field, or low-rated teachers, and you see the data there. Yes. This is only DCPS data. And what was the first part of your question?
So it's been out there. A lot of things about GPA out there. And you see the rates. And you see both of the system. But in large part, it's because of the rates.
So as I said before, students in boards 5, 7, and 8 are most likely to be suspended. Here are the data. So I love the points that you keep making. I just want to reiterate, when you're in your small groups, why do we need more professional learning around social emotional development and African achievement of teachers? Do we need to deal with how our counselors are helping teachers access students, especially make generalizations, but a lot of our students who are, they're like four characteristics. They're minority, they're poor, they're students with disabilities, and they usually, some of them are EL. So when we start disaggregating data, one child could be in four different groups because they represent all those things. And so we need to ask ourselves, what can we do differently?
One more part just read in the fact that teachers chart, it does say that it's been pulled from the ESSA plan, and that ESSA plan's chart also basically just reported also on the charter schools, and at that point, all charter schools also essentially need to get close, have to talk about the schools, the teachers, and whether they have a degree to go to help you. And to teach in a public charter school, it's not a requirement to have a degree in field. And we do know that our public charter schools do serve typically more lower-income students than higher. So I think that maybe another reason why these charts look lower is because they're being served proportionally more by public charter schools, but there's not a requirement for a degree in the field.
So I think just for my clarification, he's talking about effective rather than highly qualified. And so that's just something about what you were talking about sounds like it's measuring a different thing.
I think it's measuring both things. Very fun. It said out of the four rated effectively. So it's basically smashing together the charter school data where it's just in field versus out of field because we don't have a report of effective or ineffective in the same way. And maybe smashing together with PCPS effective/ I could be wrong.
No, because this is a data point. I went to my team and said, I don't understand this data point. Help me understand it. and they said they looked at the language.
From the ESSA plan, which is a smash of multiple different things into one chart. So I'm sure that this is potentially showing something, but I'm not exactly sure it is. And that's not your fault. That's just a thing that was in our system.
And so I guess the question is, does it matter? So if we have these outfilled and it's okay teachers in our charter schools, what does the performance data say? Are they getting the job done? And are our kids doing well? If not, that's another conversation.
Yes. But I will separately say there was a Mathematica study, though, using the growth data from the PC guest book that did show a correlation between the percentage of effective teachers at lower income schools and at higher income schools. Separately from this graph, but in that Mathematica report, there was that trend.
Louder,
that's a separate thing. Right. I just I don't know why people came out.
No, because you know the data, and we want everyone going into a small group to really inform.
Sorry.
Dr. Lowery, quick question. On this section, we had the students have not only love that student struggle teachers, but also entry who look like them. There's no data about what these students for us look like. What is, do we know what the data is about whether or not students can eat more or being served by teachers like demographically or similar?
I'm pretty sure the team couldn't find that because that's kind of private.
That's
the
economy. In math, but also even more schools differing in the trend. So you have from 0 to 100, and then you have some outliers that you don't look at the
problem. Is there any way to use this data by growth, though? So not only just in terms of proficiency, but in terms of the number of low income students they serve with the average growth percentile that they have?
So these are from your park data, Josh. Do you think you have it broken out the way she's asking?
Not currently. When we talked about me coming back and doing a part two in December, that was when I talked about using the data that's on the entry reports to do some of that same sort of discussion using the growth data instead of just
proficiency.
Yes. My intention is to be able to come back in December, but we also have to figure out a delay on that.
And so the caution that I want to put out there, that we're talking about college and career readiness, is we have to do both and, because growth is good, and expect our kids to grow, but a benchmark has to be proficiency on grade level, ready for college.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm just asking.
Okay, great. Okay. Any other questions about the data before we go into the group discussion?
I do have one additional piece of information that might be relevant to this table before we move into that discussion about equity, and that's about our percent of kids who are proficient that are white, and how that compares to other jurisdictions. And in the state of Maryland, who also takes part, the percent proficient kids, there is an equity gap there, to no surprise. The kids who are white and proficient in the test in Maryland is half what our white students are.
Is these there is an education part of the zone inequities, not the zone of culture degrees. An equity-focused mindset is focused on a structural rather than a deficit view of educational disparities. Equitable does not mean equal. We need to provide more resources to our highest paid schools. Resources are not just money. They are also people, technologies that can facilitate personalized learning, and time. An equitable education system holds all students to the same high expectations and differentiates resources based on need. And finally, when setting expectations for schools, we need to prioritize fairness to students, that's equity, when we look at individual needs, versus fairness to schools. When we fund all schools equally and give them all the same amount of money, that's equality, but that's not equity. We're not focusing on the children who sit in those schools. And then there are descriptors for each one. Then you're going to go to the framework and answer those questions. And as I said, you can take a moment and do it individually before you go hold your discussion, or the group can just go ahead and get up and just get right in. You decide that. And then this is the ultimate goal. After you discuss in your groups, your how responses based on the questions, you've got to find agreement at your table. You've got to come to consensus and stuff. There's probably going to be some places where you may agree or disagree. But what we're focused on then is where can you find common agreement around some of these principles of the how questions. And then you as groups are going to come back to the big room, and we're going to have each group report out how it's going to happen.
That's what we're going to start with, yes.
Okay, so and then you maybe can even do a walk around and let people see where their common theme or characteristics. Anyway, because what we want you to do tonight, and it may be something, everything is always iterative, right? But by the end of the night, we want you to have come to consensus on at least some characteristics or common themes of which we agree around equity. So we just ask for the team to talk about equity and all kinds of talk about this. So we're going to start with Alex. Well, we'll start with Alex. One, two, three, four.
Two's down here.
That is true.
Yes, I saw that on here.
Who was your advisor? what their competency is.
Okay, so here's your clip chart paper.
Your, that's your academic conflict through what you perceive as the common theme and you want to move into a definition for equity.
All right.
Thank you.
It goes
outputs with like equality and equity and how we kind of want an equal output, but then we recognize that the inputs are not going to all be the same, but then we know they're important when measuring and when thinking about report cards, thinking about all the things when we're kind of driving with this equity and our mission of the task force. So we had that. Then within outputs, we were having a discussion about kind of the standardization and the importance of that to maybe be able to see kind of throughout the system and figure out if we are in fact trying to achieve our goals. But then kind of the struggle is if you do everything the same, isn't that possibly inequitable? Because frankly, not everyone is going to be successful in the same measurements. And so if we're only using kind of a limited measure, like say a park test, to define that that's when we've achieved equity, that then perhaps we have not done so. But that if we don't have anything at all like that, then we kind of fall off the deep end in another way. And so it's all kind of this balancing that we're struggling with. And that, frankly, then there's kind of policy implications for how you kind of come to that definition. Potentially in terms of who's then making decisions about spending resources and then deciding if they're achieving the results. And so then that can get real messy, the kind of more you differentiate. But then ultimately, and I don't know, I didn't run this by the whole group, but that kind of our goal, when whatever definition we do come up with, is to find a way to both measure the inputs and the outputs in a way that can hopefully successfully achieve said goal of the very complicated term of equity.
All right, so, I'm Daniel. When I was in group two, we basically decided the definition of equity, the broad definition at least, is that equity is giving individuals, such as students, families, and schools, what they need to be able to reach high expectations or succeed. We also stress taking into account historical and present-day inequities, like poverty. Like, poverty is also like just a growing trend, stuff like that. We also stress heavily equity is not giving everybody the equal resources to be able to achieve goals, but instead being able to focus groups that need more resources and giving them more resources for them to be able to reach that goal. For example, you know, we have like race inequalities and stuff like that. So maybe you'd be able to give Hispanic, those people more resources and able to get them to the equilibrium as well with just whites and stuff. But like giving them more resources instead of giving white more resources to be able to bring them up to that same caliber. If that made any sense, I'm sorry if I didn't, but one of the questions we reached, and this was like one of the main questions we reached that we couldn't really get through, is how to actually do it, since that goes back to, as what the person previously was saying, it's very confusing and very hard to actually get through with it, but that's the point of this, to figure it out, so that's that.
That to be the case, and we have to understand and honor that we haven't done right by folks.
we talked about our that oftentimes we set these as expectations, but that goes into resource distribution, which then leads to equity. We talked about the fact that our disparities are numerous and varied. So oftentimes we talk about disparities as just being around academic outcomes, but many times those disparities are in many different ways. And that goes into family struggles are inequitable, right? We talk about so much about the results for kids are inequitable, but actually they're like what are the things our families are dealing with are inequitable to begin with, and that pours into what our kids are experiencing and what we're seeing. And then we also just had to like kind of own the fact that equity is expensive, it's time consuming, but that when you pour in the money and you pour in the time and the heart, it's effective. And so how do we get to that at the end? So kind of what we came to in a final definition, that was hard, but Jack saved the day right at the end, was we think that equity is kind of about a collective community decision that ensures that each student receives the resources, and we put a little asterisk by that because that is many things define resources that they need to succeed. So.
Four.
Well, you. We're yielding all of our time.
Schools, you have unfairness with all of the groups and other schools like private, public, charter, DCPS, like all of them. I think that it says more like stop. Okay, some of the levels that you put them on are more high than some of the other ones, so I think that you should stop, like, put some of them. Like stop them on a different level so the others can get where basically like put them on the same level basically. Community schools vision for the whole city, implicit bias, symptom of societal issues, parent resources. I really don't get what the implicit bias comes in, but the definition that we ended up coming to was allocating resources so that the sum of all historical and present injustice are remedied so that every child has an equal starting point and level playing field. I don't know if that makes sense. Children, in order for them to be successful.
successful individuals as they become adults, they need to be able to also be able to know the world and know how to navigate through it. And so this is just the beginning point. If you have any questions or you feel you want to go and add to what you see up there, please feel free to do that. We do have our takeaway. We do have our exit slip. And if you want to, if you have a suggestion of other important speakers or topics that we need to discuss before we dive into our committees, please suggest them. I'd like to thank Dr. Lord for coming tonight and sharing with us.
Some common themes across these four definitions. But those common themes across these four definitions aren't reflected in the, to me, completely in the ESSA framework. So we will have a report card that has this overall value slash number slash star to it that does not reflect the things that we have determined that are working around equity at this table. To what degree does this group have influence some of the technical definitions of the metrics that are applied in the SSR framework to reflect what this group finds to be important around equity?
We know what OSSE is doing is just the starting point, and the purpose of us gathering the information throughout our communities is so that we can begin to drive over time some of what goes on the report card beyond that of what is required by law. A lot of what I see in the community is valid and deserves some place on the report card. And even the fact that we can have more conversations around, these are the items that we also see as a committee, as a task force, of bringing up to the State Board of Education as something that could become a recommendation to us. And the point is that the more and more times we have our focus groups and we're out there in the community and we're putting it down in writing, and there's all that data collection of how important something means to the community. However, I do recognize that data is somewhat something that most parents, they don't see as important on a report card. I always go back to the fact of having the skill set that I have. I was able to walk around and visit the schools that I wanted my children to go to. And the first question I asked is, I know you're a high-performing school. I just want to know, what growth are you going to do with my child at your high-performing school? And if they couldn't tell me or share with me how they were gathering information for each individual child, because that goes back to individualized lesson plans. Every child should have one. Coming from a special education perspective, we need to look at each individual child and identify what their needs are, and that's true equity, getting to that. So I'm not sure I answered your question, Josh, but it's a direction that we have to keep pushing and moving in. So we will have the opportunity to make suggestions and eventually vote on what we see as important to push up to the State Board of Education as our recommendations for them to take a closer look. Any other questions? Next month, we kind of have been thrown a curveball because now I know after trying to get that equity report, I've been working on it every day. It doesn't look like it's going to be ready. I have spoken with OSSE and they have assured assured us that it'll be out hopefully before the FS, but it won't give us enough time to really dive into it so that we could address it here as a group. So our next session, we will be looking more closely at equity. We'll be looking at how equity could drive, the topic of equity could drive our committees. In some of what you all put up there, it seems like it's a concept, and it will drive us moving more into how we can make recommendations that way. OSSE will present next in December on what the data they gathered based on the rest of this month, next month. And in my mind, in some way or another, I think it's really important that now that we have more information in order to give a better picture of how we would do or what our responses to the focus group would be different. And so we did it as a mock. I would love to see us do it again, and it would probably be a different picture than it was when we first did it. So any questions or anything that you all see really you want, is burning desire you want me to get to dive deeper in for you, please email us, and Maria is the person to email because she keeps track of all that for me, and then I can make sure I try to go out there and get the best person to come speak to us.
I was going to leave this alone, but I want to piggyback on what Josh said. You know, when affirmative action first started, nobody bore any consequences one way or the other until they started building how you actually perform into your performance evaluation and your pay and your advancement. And so that's what the star rating is for us. So if there's no consequence to not moving any closer to equity,
right,
is all of this and all the resources that are being expended and everything we do is the end of the point. So we need to, I know that's a rhetorical question, I hope it is, but let us think about what are the consequences?
And
if it's not a star, what is it?
I totally agree with you. It's as if when I sit down and have conversations with other educators besides yourselves about this topic, the first thing that always comes to my mind is that if I had to look at the star system and I see where you're going to have the same 10 schools that are always going to be the five, that again goes back to why my children, how I looked at it from that perspective. I went to school and I said, well, all of you would be a five. But if I was to look at another graph that was on a report card that showed me that you took and you grew that group of children, I would be more likely to send my child to school that grew children, even though they were both five stars. So in other words, as we look at a report card, we're going to need to think about other ways to reward the school.
Growth is one of the ways you get your stuff. I just want to make sure that you're looking at disaggregated data,
right,
in the growth.
Exactly.
Okay.
And pulling it out. I mean, what is wrong with our report cards besides having star, but also having this other little piece to it that allows us to look closely at it? Some of the states are doing that. Some are using a stop sign or red, yellow, green, or whatever. And if you're red, that means that you may be at this level, but you're not showing any progress in your school. I mean, the children are coming already with something. What are you adding to it? And so to just focus totally on that being the top of our report card, I would have a problem with that as the person that has children in the system. And so that may be something that our parents may not be able to express, but we can, as a task force, really look deep into that.
If I can remind people around the x-y-axis of the outliers, if we look at those schools who have high poverty, high
that will somehow